Hi, I'm Bill Kleitz, Professor of Electrical Engineering Technology at the State University of New York's Tompkins-Cortland campus. I'm also the author of several electronics textbooks with Prentice Hall. If you want more information about me or my textbooks, you can Google me at Prentice Hall or at Amazon.com. The podcast that you're going to be watching is from the 9th edition of my digital electronics textbook. I hope you find it useful.
Hi, this is Professor Kleitz. In Chapter 15, I'm going to talk about interfacing to the analog world. As you know, the world is analog, whether it's temperature, pressure, or sound pressures, voice. They all have to be converted to digital strings in order to be understood by digital systems or computers. So first of all, I'm going to talk about the difference between analog and digital representations, and then the building block for these converters are operational amplifiers. Then we'll look at the binary weighted digital to analog, the R2R ladder digital to analog converter, and then we'll look at some integrated circuit D2A converters and their specifications. And then we'll switch gears and go the other way, analog to digital, counter wrap analog to digital, and then talk about the successive approximation method for that type of conversion, look at integrated circuits, and then we'll put it all together in data acquisition systems, and then we'll look at the actual transducers and signal conditioning circuits that are needed for these analog sensors. So just to give you a better idea of what I'm talking about, this is a typical analog signal. Let's say that we were trying to monitor the temperature during the day, and at one point it was kind of cold, and then it got warmer and warmer and warmer, and then it got cold again. Or in our case, we're talking about milliseconds of change, so we possibly have some sort of a temperature controller, let's say, that's outputting an analog voltage that changes over time, and we want to take a sample every millisecond of this voltage that gets created. So at the 1 millisecond mark, we're measuring 3 volts, and then 1 millisecond later, at the 2 millisecond mark, it increases to 5. And as often as we take these samples, the more often we take them, the more accurate our data points will be, because if we went from 1 to 1.5 milliseconds, we would have found this point here, and if we went to 2.5, we would have found this point here. And then what if we went to 1 1/4 second? So this is the sampling rate. How often do you take a sample per second? The other issue is when we take a sample, we have to convert that analog value into a digital string. Now the number 3 is easy. That would be just the 1 1, the least significant bit. But what we're going to do with this signal is convert it into a 4-bit string. So we get 1 of 16 possible differences. But what if the value wasn't 3? What if it was 3.5? We would have missed out on that, because there's no way to represent 3.5. So we would have to have a 5th bit or a 6th bit or more. So some of the analog to digital converters are actually going to be 10-bit, 12-bit, or even 14-bit, so that we can get tighter and tighter resolution. So let's look at the representation of this with the indicated sample points that I'm taking. So at the 1 millisecond mark, like I said, we're going to have the number 3. So at 1 millisecond, the analog value is 3, and if we're converting this to a 4-bit string, that would be 0011, and then at 5, at the 2 millisecond, it's 5, so 2 millisecond, it's 5, and so this is what happens. Even if this was a human voice and you were recording music, the human voice signal might go higher and higher, lower and lower, and you're taking all these samples, creating all of these bit strings that correspond to each data point. And then you're storing these ones and zeros. If it's music, it's going to be on a CD or in an MP3 or something like that. If it's your cell phone, it's being converted into a digital string before it's transmitted. So all these ones and zeros are going to be used to represent our analog values. And then on the receiving end, you're going to take all these digital values, convert them back into analog before it's played back for the human to hear. So in block diagram form, what we have is some analog value coming in and a digital string coming out. And what I'm illustrating here is, what if you had 10 volts And according to our chart, at the 10 millisecond mark, we happen to have 10 volts. Actually, at the 9 millisecond mark, we had also 10. And the number 10 in binary is 1010, and that's what you'd see on the digital output. This is a 4-bit A to D converter. It gives you one of 16 possible outputs. Now, the basic building blocks of A to D and D to A circuits require the use of an operational amplifier for signal conditioning. There are three characteristics of op-amps that make them almost ideal. The first characteristic is that it has a very high input impedance. In other words, the input into the negative, the inverting input terminal, and the impedance looking in at the positive terminal is almost infinite. Very high. It also has a very high voltage gain. So in other words, the difference between these two voltages is amplified into a much larger signal at the output. Very high voltage gain. It's also got a very low output impedance. So if you're at the output and you look back into the op amp, the impedance that's right near the output terminal is very low. So let's look at this op amp circuit in figure 15-2. This is called a feedback resistor. When you connect the resistor from the output back into the inverting input, this creates negative feedback. Negative feedback creates a point right here at point G called virtual ground. This point acts like ground. It's not really ground, but it acts like ground. In other words, if you ground the positive terminal and this point is virtual ground, that means there's no voltage differential between the negative and the positive. It's actually going to be microvolts, but it's very small. So with zero differential between these two points, this point would be the same as this point, which is connected to ground. Now if this is ground and this is ground, we have a battery essentially that's in parallel with RI, because this point is actually connected to here, this point is connected to here, so the 5 volts is right across 10K. That's how I got the current flow of 0.5 milliamps leaving the positive battery. Conventional current goes to this point. It cannot go in here because of the high input impedance. It scoots around the outside, goes through the feedback resistor, and this 0.5 travels all the way through. So this VR dictate the current flow that's going to end up in the feedback resistor. Now that current flow times a 1K creates a voltage across the RF resistor, and when you're at the output looking back, that's what you see. Negative IF RF connected to ground. So written as an equation, VL is negative the VI over RI times the RF. So in our case, we've said it was 0.5 milliamps. It's a 1K resistor. So the output voltage at this point would be negative 0.5 volts. So we're going to use that principle in solving a few op amp circuits. And notice I abbreviate operational amplifiers, just call them op amps. And this is what's called an adder circuit. We're adding the current from the 10 volt 5K comes to this point and scoots around the RF. And then the 12 volt 10K comes through here, scoots around the RF. These two currents will be added. This is going to be an adder. And the math for this is going to be the current in the 10K, first of all, this 10K right here is the 12 volts over 10K, 1.2 mA. The current through the 5K is going to be 10 volts over 5K, which is 2 mA. Add these two together for 3.2 mA. That's what's going to end up going through the 2K resistor up here. And you multiply that times 2K, you get negative 6.4 volts. So we're going to use this principle when we build our first D to A converter. So we'll start off by doing digital to analog. So we were talking earlier about analog to digital, but let's start out with a digital to analog. These are a little bit easier to understand. And the basic DAC can be built by expanding on the information we just presented. In the previous example, we showed that the 2K resistor received the sum of the currents heading toward the op amp from the two input resistors. If we scale the input resistors properly with a binary weighting factor, each input can be made to provide a binary weighted amount of current, and the output voltage will represent the sum of all of the binary weighted currents, as we'll see in this next diagram. And these are binary weighted resistors. The first resistor on the right hand side for the least significant bit is 100K. This we'll call the 1 bit. And if you have this as 1/2 the size, this will be double the current, right? So this will be double the current. And then if you look at the 100K compared to the 25K, that's going to be 1/4, four times the current, I should say. Actually, so when 1/2 the resistance is double the current flow. And then from the 100K to here is four times the current flow. And then 100K to the D3 is 8 times the current flow. So the actual current flows will be in a binary progression. So in fact, the current through the 100K when you close the least significant switch, 5 volts divided by 100K is 0.05 milliamps flowing down through, or 50 microamps, 0.05 milliamps flowing down here and through the feedback resistor. When you close this switch, 5 volts over 50K is 0.1 milliamps. 5 volts over 25K is 0.2 milliamps. And then 5 volts over 12.5K is 0.4 milliamps. And you'll notice that they got bigger by doubling. So we had 0.05, 0.1, 0.2, 0.4. So we get this doubling effect. This is called the binary weighting method. No matter which switch you close, or if you close them all or any combination of them, they send their current through the 20K. So whatever those currents were we just said, multiply it times the 20K, that gives you the negative voltage at the output. So this chart in figure 15.4 B shows the voltages that get created. So for example, if the D0 switch is closed, you take that current, which was 0.05 mA times 20K, do the math on that, you'll get 1 volt. Now these are negative voltages. You close the second one, you get 2 volts. You close just the third, the D2 switch, you get 4 volts. And close just the D3 switch, you get 8 volts. And then any combinations of these sums will produce this chart. So what we have is a 4-bit digital input and a single analog output. And in example 15.2, I'll show you the math for this one. So let's say that we close the switches for the number 10 on the D3 to D0 switches. So number 10 is really a 1010, right? The 8-bit and the 2-bit. So if you close the D3 switch and the D1 switch, well, the D3 switch produces a current I3. That would be 5 volts over the 12.5. Like I said, that's 0.4 milliamps. And the D1 switch is going to give you 5 over 50K, the 0.1 milliamp. Add these two currents together, send them through the feedback resistor, and you'll end up with minus 10 volts. So this is just one data point on that table we just saw. So if you go back to that circuit and try to decide how could we get an 8-bit D to A, let's take a look at that circuit 1 minute. So this was a 4-bit D to A, so to get a D4 switch, we'd have to have the next resistor be half of this. What would that be, 6.25? And then the next switch, if you wanted to have the D5 switch, you'd have to have half of that, which would be half of the 6.25. That would be 3.125, and then the next switch would be half of that, so you got to take half of the 3.125, the next switch would be half of that, and half of that, and so on. You see that these resistors get ridiculously small and inaccurate. It's very difficult to get resistors that are exact binary weighted resistors. So we have a new technique called the R2R method for D to A, and we'll look at that in the next section.